I'd like to call to order the January 20th, 2015 City Council meeting and have roll call, please.
Mayor Dukes?
Here.
Vice Mayor Buckland?
Here.
Councilmember Cleveland?
Here.
Councilmember Didball?
Here.
Councilmember Gill?
Here. All right, if we could all please stand for the invocation by Councilmember Buckland and then followed by the Pledge of Allegiance by, let's see, who will we have do it tonight? I think we'll have Councilmember Didball. Do the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
If you bow your heads with me, please. Dear wise and loving Father, first let me say thank you on behalf of all those that are gathered here today. Thank you for this day and the plentiful blessings that you provide each of us. Thank you for the ability to be involved in useful work and for the honor of bearing appropriate responsibilities. I pray for your guidance in this meeting tonight. Please give us an assurance of what would please you and what would benefit those that live and work in Yuba City. It's in your most blessed name I pray. Amen. Amen. Pledge.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. Mr. Hayes, could you give us a report out of closed session, please?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. In closed session, the City Council, by a 5-0 vote, approved an employment agreement with the Fire Management Group.
All right. Thank you. And first item on the agenda is the retirement of Recreation Supervisor Verna Cook-Stoddard. If you could please come down front here.
In case you don't like what he says.
Yeah, you can hit me. Yeah.
No.
That's what I did to get this cane.
I'm going to have you turn around so everybody
has a chance. Oh, okay.
Also.
All right. Thank you, Mayor.
I have the shortened version here, so we won't read all the whereases. We have two people tonight that are retiring from our Parks and Recreation Department with a total of 54 years of service for the city, and that's pretty amazing. And Verna Cook began her 25-year career with Yuba City Parks and Recreation in August of 1989. Over her many years with the Parks and Recreation Department, Verna made the Senior Center a welcoming atmosphere and developed numerous programs and activities for seniors, such as fitness programs, arts and crafts, which were offered weekly, a computer media device class, senior nutrition program, CDBG handyman program for seniors, and Southern North Health for the Walk in the Park program. Oh, those are some great programs that will be a great legacy for the city. Verna has implemented several community partnerships, including Sutter County Commission on Aging, Senior Information and Assistance, HICAP and FREED, Sutter County Health Department, AARP, Alzheimer's Association, Del Oro Caregiver, Walgreen and Rite Aid Pharmacies, and Yuba City Rotary Club. Verna continued the growth and success of many programs and activities that were put in her charge, and you're going to be truly missed at the Senior Center, I know. I've had the privilege of being there several Christmases and lighting the Christmas tree and with the dinners that she puts on there for the seniors, and they love you. And I know that you have some big shoes to fill. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, John Dukes, Mayor of Yuba City, on behalf of the entire City Council, do hereby honor and commend Verna Cook-Stoddard for 25 years of service to the Yuba City Parks and Recreation Department and the City of Yuba City, also to all the citizens of Yuba City and Sutter County, and wish her much success and happiness in her well-deserved retirement. Done on this 20th day of January, 2015. At the City of Yuba City, County of Sutter in California. Thank you. Would you like to say anything?
Abby is the, she told me I had to speak for both of us, but she's going to say something. I just have had a wonderful career here at the city, and my family's all here, and they grew up in Parks and Rec. Like everybody knows that if you have a parent in Parks and Rec, you automatically, your first job is volunteer. And so and I think it does wonderful for kids to be part of that. And I've met so many wonderful seniors that they enriched my life as much as I think I have theirs. So I haven't got to the point where I miss anything too much yet. I'd like to get rid of the cane, you know. I thought I better retire before I was in a wheelchair permanently.
Well, just know that you're always welcome at the Senior Citizen Center also. Thank you very much. And next we have Abby Cecina. Abby Cecina began her 29-year career as a recreation supervisor with Yuba City Parks and Recreation in October of 1985. During her career, Abby implemented and contributed with the growth and success of many programs and activities that were put in her charge that are too many to include, but I'll read a few of them. The annual Haunted House, Corporate Challenge, Cultural Celebration, Children's Areas at the Prune Festival and the Yuba Sutter Fair, the Harvest Festival, the Polar Bear Plunge, which is still a very popular event each year, Movies and Concerts in the Park, which I attended many of those, and the community loves those. Youth Track and Field, annual Arbor Day celebration, and oversaw the day-to-day operations of Gaucher Aquatic Park. Abby has had the honor of receiving multiple awards, which include the Best Place to Take Kids, the Best Park, awarded by the Appeal Democrat for the past 5 years, Gaucher Aquatic Park. Received the Ellis & Associates Award of Excellence Bronze Award in 2008, 9, and the Silver Award in 2010, 11, and 12. The CPRS Award, Excellence in Cultural Celebration. And Abby has sat on numerous boards and commissions, including the Juvenile Justice Commission, the Prune Festival Parade Board, Sutter Performing Arts Association, Friends of Yuba City Parks and Recreation Foundation, the Rotary Club of Yuba City, and the committee member for the United Way. It's quite a bit of things that she's participated in this community, and you have done a lot for the city. Now, therefore, it be resolved that I, John Dukes, Mayor of Yuba City, on behalf of the entire City Council, do hereby honor and commend Abby Cecina for her 29 years of service to the city, Yuba City Parks and Recreation Department, Yuba City, and to the people of Yuba City and Sutter County. Wish her much success and happiness in her well-deserved retirement on this 20th day of January 2015 in Yuba City, California. And you get to speak to it.
I was just going to say everything Verna said, but she was a stand-up comedian, and so I just wanted to say thank you so much to the community. I've raised my family here. I had both my kids in Yuba City. They've, same as Verna's, grew up here in the recreation department. Have put in numerous hours volunteering, and it's just been a great run. So thank you to everybody and to the council.
All right. Next we have the Yuba City Police Officer of the Year Award, and I'd like to have Christopher Oakley come forward, please.
Thank you.
Let's get the whole family up here. You hold that, or maybe have your wife hold that for you then. The 2014 Officer of the Year, Officer Christopher Oakley. On behalf of the City Council, I'm proud to recognize Christopher Oakley as the Yuba City Police Department's 2014 Officer of the Year. Over the past 7 years, Officer Oakley has distinguished himself as a diligent, steadying force within the police department and as a field training officer, patrol officer, traffic officer, honor guard, and skilled sniper for the SWAT team. He has law enforcement expertise, and his heart of service have resulted in impressive achievements as a field training officer. Officer Oakley ensures the finest in policing for newly hired police officers. He imparts the skill and training necessary to deliver an officer who upholds the highest standards for the citizens of Yuba City. Officer Oakley, As a reserve officer coordinator, Chris designed training scenarios to enhance the skills of reserve officers. His skills and depth of understanding of teamwork makes him invaluable for the SWAT team, always seeking the success of the team before personal achievement. Officer Oakley is looked upon as a leader among his peers. He is sought out by junior officers for advice and guidance, and is always leading during calls for service. Supervisors describe him as an unassuming leader who does not shy away from the challenge and expects the same from others. People who have chosen law enforcement as their career have made the decision to give their lives, if necessary, to save others. Officer Chris Oakley has chosen to dedicate himself to the protection and development of his fellow employees. Never one to seek personal glory, Chris has measured his success and achievements of others. Congratulations, Chris.
Well, I'll keep it short and sweet. I'd like to thank everybody, with the exception of Kenny Souls, for being here tonight. There'll be a shredder by the door on the way out if you guys would like to drop those baseball cards there. Again, I thank God for the opportunity to do this job, and I bring my family up here because every officer in this room can attest that with a career as demanding as law enforcement, behind a good officer or behind somebody whose peers think they're a good officer is a supportive family, and through the thick and thin, my daughter finds my birthmark a little interesting. They've always been there, been supportive, regardless of the calls, the call outs, or anything else. And so I've got to thank my family for being there for me as well. Thank you.
And also, I'd like to invite Lucy Merrill to step forward. All right, 2014 Employee of the Year, Community Service Officer, Lucy Morrell. On behalf of the City Council, it is my distinct pleasure to honor Community Service Officer Lucy Morrell, the recognition of Police Department Employee of the Year for 2014. Lucy has demonstrated unparalleled effectiveness and diligence of upholding the department's mission and values. Her respectful, positive, and compassionate demeanor fosters the highest level of confidence for citizens seeking assistance from the police department. Her respectful, positive, and compassionate demeanor fosters the highest level of confidence. I just read that, didn't I? Okay, sorry. In 2014, her skills proved critical in identifying a suspect in the largest mall fraud case ever by handling the Yuba City Police by the Yuba City Police Department. She tirelessly pored over hundreds of pieces of evidence and ran down the leads, resulting in the suspect now facing federal charges. Lucy was praised by her efforts by the U.S. Postal Inspector, who recognized her. Without this work, this case may not have made its way to the federal courtroom for prosecution. She went above and beyond to solve a large-scale credit card fraud case relating to a nationally publicized database breach at Home Depot. Working with Staples, CVS Pharmacy, and numerous victims, Lucy developed the suspect information and arrest was made. Lucy's diligence stopped this thief and provided tangible proof for those victims of the Yuba City Police Department commitment to protecting our citizens. Her unwavering work ethic, humble service, and positive attitudes made her the obvious choice to stand at the head of her peer group for this year. Congratulations, Lucy.
I just want to say what an honor it is to work with this great group of people and work for the city. Really an honor. Thank you.
Give a minute here for the room to settle down. No, probably not. Yeah. Yeah, I know. Just a few. We have a few empty seats for all of those standing in the back if they'd like to come forward and sit down. All right, moving on to item number 5, introduction of Recology General Manager Michael Leggins. Mr. Leggins, if you could come to the podium.
Mayor Dukes and council members, I want to thank you for this opportunity of being introduced and also just to kind of briefly introduce myself as well. I'm a civil engineer, graduate of Sac State, 35 years as an engineer working in water, wastewater, solid waste, hazardous waste projects, which is, I think, an important element in the issues that we have out at Recology Yuba Center. And obviously, with the police here, I can attest that I have a great background check. So, I'm relocating actually from Eureka, Humboldt County area to Yuba City, and look forward to getting to know you more, working with you as we progress in our projects. Thank you.
Well, we'd like to welcome you to our community and thank you for taking the time to introduce yourself. Thank you, Michael. Public communication. You are welcome and encouraged to participate in this meeting. The public is taken. Public comment is taken on items listed on the agenda when they are called. Public comment on items not listed on the agenda will be heard at this time. Comments on controversial items may be limited, and large groups are encouraged to select representatives to express their opinions of the group. Is there anyone who would like to speak on something that is not on the agenda tonight? Right, seeing no one, we will move on to written requests. Members of the public submitting written requests at least 24 hours prior to the meeting will normally be allotted 5 minutes to speak. And I do have a number of people who have given written requests and will be taking those when that item comes up on the agenda. Appearance of interested citizens. Members of the public may address the City Council on items of interest that are within the City's jurisdiction. Individuals addressing general comments are encouraged to limit their statements to 3 minutes. All right. Is there anyone that... All right. Moving on to public hearings. Item number 8. Accept the grant funding and expenditure recommendations for the California Citizens Operation for Public Safety COPS grant of $100,000. Chief Landon.
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Each year, depending upon the state budget priorities, funds may be allocated to law enforcement agencies to assist in carrying out priorities as established by the chief of police and the sheriff of sheriff in the areas of unincorporated places or contract cities. Over the last several years, monies have been made available through the state of California to local law enforcement entities in the form of the Citizens Option for Public Safety grant. This year, the city of Yuba City will receive approximately $100,000. The state government restricts the money to be used for frontline law enforcement purposes and may not be used to supplant any existing law enforcement services currently provided by the city. Traditionally, we've utilized the funding to obtain the grant for major approval of expenditure categories of technology advancements and infrastructure improvements for the benefit of frontline law enforcement delivery to the citizens of our community. Prior year's expenditures have been for such items as complete infrastructure upgrade of the police radio system, inclusive acquisition of a secondary repeater, radio frequency and related equipment, several other interoperability projects, emergency operations center retrofit, a total service weapons upgrade for all the officers, equipping all patrol vehicles with mobile data terminals integrated with the police communications centers. And we've recently started to trend that and using the mobile audio videos in the vehicles. And some of the things that we would like to continue or suggest a continuation along the path of technology evaluation and implementation, which has garnished just real good results in the last 10 years. In addition to looking at the stuff as the technology has developed, we'd like to also purchase mobile personal recording video equipment for the officers, and that's approximately $1,000 a piece. We'd like to buy 20 cameras. We don't want to buy all 40 of them at one time. That means we'd have to replace them every 4 years at the exact same time. So we'd like to buy them in two different increments, 20 this year, 20 next year. And we'd also like to continue with the mobile audio recorders for the vehicles. I believe right now we have two more that we need to purchase for vehicles that aren't currently equipped with it. The fiscal impact, it's about $100,000 approximately for the grant with no city match. The alternatives is to provide staff with alternative spending paths, which will not supplant routine expenditures to the general fund. And the recommendation of staff is to adopt a resolution authorizing the chief of police to accept the fiscal year 2014-2015 California Citizens Option for Public Safety funding and approve expenditure recommendations. Further authorize the chief financial officer to make budget adjustments as necessary to the necessary accounts. With that, I'll entertain any questions, or actually it's a public hearing.
Thank you, Chief. Is there any questions council at this time?
Not at this time.
Seeing none, I will open the public hearing and invite members of the public to come and speak on this item. But nobody wants to speak on it. All right, close the public hearing. Any further questions of council? Seeing none, I will entertain a motion.
To the mayor.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to approve staff's recommendation.
I'll second. All right, I have a motion and a second. Any further comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, unanimous.
Thank you, and go Hawks.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You should have said that before the vote, Chief.
No, it was appropriate, yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
All right. Item number 9, fiscal year 2015 to 2020 Community Development Block Grant Consolidation Plan Overview. Darren Gale.
Good evening, Mayor Dukes and council members. It's a pleasure to be before you this evening to talk about our Community Development Block Grant Program. That's hopefully the last time I'll say that. I'll call it the CDBG, and hopefully I won't mess up that acronym too much. Each and every year, our city receives, we're an entitlement city through the federal government to receive funding for a variety of different projects. The funding is approximately about $550,000 a year. And let me just talk a little bit about the CDBG program. It is a federally funded program, and there's a few different priorities that we have to meet as we implement funding through the CDBG program. And those are provide decent housing, to provide suitable living environments, expand economic opportunities, and the program should also benefit low and moderate income persons. As I mentioned, as an entitlement city, each year we receive approximately $500,000. It's a little bit above that. And every 5 years, we have the opportunity of adopting what's called a consolidated plan, a five-year consolidated plan. And right now we're going through this process, and this is the opportunity that I'm before you this evening to discuss that as an informational item and for you to provide any feedback through this process. In addition to the five-year consolidated plan that will go before council, and I'll talk about the timelines, there's also an annual work plan that's put together. And that annual work plan basically helps dictate how the funds are used each and every year. There is an application process, a review process internally, and then it comes before council for approval. The five-year plan, as it's created, really relies on census data and citizen participation. We have a consultant that's with us here this evening who helps us put that together, and she's a great resource that has experience in community development block grant funding, and Carol Stewart, thank you, and she helps put together the census data. A key part of it also is public participation. We have a survey that was sent out in late December to all of our past recipients, and tomorrow we'll have a press release going out encouraging the public to really participate in this program to help us identify what are these needs that meet the criteria of the community development's block grant funds. Currently, we've only received 20 responses, and the majority of those have come from service providers. So obviously, the public opinion right now is very much weighted towards providing services to those folks. In addition, we'll have a public meeting. That public meeting is scheduled for February 17th at 11 a.m. in the Sutter Room here at City Hall. As I mentioned, the citizen participation is key. The press release will go out. Also this year, we have included the Chamber of Commerce, and it's supposed to go out in their next email so we can have additional participation from the business community as it relates to some of the priorities for economic development. The action plan, I want to talk a little bit about that. So first, every year we put out a request for funding. That this year went out January 9th. This year it's currently, it's all done online, and applications are due by March 5th. As part of this consolidated plan, this five-year plan that we're working on, we'll come to council and on April 7th is our plan to bring a draft consolidated plan back to council for consideration, and we will have a public meeting at that time and have as much public comment as needed. After that, there's a 30-day period for additional comments, and then the final draft will become before council May 5th, and if approved, we will submit both the consolidated plan, the five-year plan, and that one-year annual plan by mid to late May, because I believe it's due before June 1st. Is that correct, or June 30th? June 1st. So as relates to funding, I want to talk a little bit specifically what are the requirements of where this funding makes improvements. So first of all, it has to benefit at least 70% a low-income person. And ask me one of these three different objectives, the national objectives of CDBG. So low-income benefits, slum or blight elimination, urgent community development needs, housing, property improvements, and a variety of different things. Let me just talk about a couple example of projects that could be funded each and every year. So we have a rent and mortgage payment assistance, ADA accessibility improvements, public facility improvements. Our hands event each and every year is funded through this program. And also we have a great handyman program for disabled and seniors that is funded each and every year. So over the past 5 years, the city received $2.7 million, and this is where your funding went in dollars and percentages. As relates to public facilities, that money went for city ADA improvements. Butchie Pool had accessibility improvements that they made, the Salvation Army. As it relates to housing and rehabilitation projects, that went to places like Casa de Esperanza. There was a solar grant program that was out there. Freed Resources for Independent Living received money for a fix-it program for disabled. And then for public services, mainly for a lot of homeless programs, Again, Salvation Army received funding, Hands Up Ministry, a Homeless Veteran Assistance, Hands of Hope, Bridges to Help, and St. Vincent's de Paul all received funding over these past 5 years. So it's a significant amount of funding each and every year that goes out. As we're putting together this five-year plan, obviously we'd love to hear kind of priorities from the City Council. This is an informational item, but as I mentioned, we would love to hear your input if you have any. It'll be back before the City Council in April for a true public hearing, and you'll have a draft plan. Also, that meeting in February is a great place where we can hopefully have the public attend. But we'd love to hear the opinion of the council members and where you might like to see these funding sources, directed towards based upon the requirements of CDBG.
All right. Thank you. Any questions or comments and direction to staff on this item? I will say that the public sidewalks, including the ADA improvements, have been something that we have spent, as you can see, a lion's share of the money on, and it certainly is a program that has been very valuable to our community. Darren, do you know approximately what percentage of intersections that we still have left to bring up to standards for ADA?
I do not know the percentage, but there's still, a lot of intersections.
Quite a few. Okay.
Improvements.
All right. At this time, I'd like to open up public hearing and invite anyone from the public who'd like to speak on this item or give suggestions of where you'd like to see us spend these funds. Step to the podium. All right. Seeing none, close the public hearing and bring it back to the council for any other further comments. I believe this is just a note and file, so we don't have to take any action, but if there's comments, entertain those.
The only comments I'd like to make is we've done a fairly decent job of starting to provide some intervention for our homeless groups that are out there. I'd like to see some consolidation of those programs through these efforts. Maybe a little wiser use of the money and more direct use into evacuating individuals from that condition that they're currently in, and trying to find other options other than the river bottoms adjacent to some of our large housing projects on the south end of town. So that would be one of the efforts I'd like to see us delve into.
Any other comments? All right, thank you, Darren. Moving on to item number 10, ordinances. California Public Employees Retirement System Contract Amendment to Implement Employee Cost Sharing. Natalie Walter.
Sorry to interrupt you. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Tonight, I am here before you to go over the CalPERS Contract Amendment for Cost Sharing. This is being done to implement the bargaining unit contracts for the mid-managers, first levels, police officers association, and the police sergeants. This is transitioning the first phase and transitioning out the furlough and transitioning in cost sharing or employees cost sharing. When I say cost sharing, that means the employees are paying towards their retirement, their pension, towards the retirement CalPERS benefits for classic members. The reason why I use the word classic members is that our new members, our new CalPERS members are already paying towards their share of retirement benefit costs in accordance with pension reform. This is the first of two cost-sharing amendments required by the bargaining contracts. The classic safety members, which would be our police members, police sergeants, and our officers, will be cost-sharing 4.5% after this amendment is complete, and the miscellaneous will cost-share 4% or 3.5% of their pension, dependent on, and that the reason why the differential in those two amounts is it's dependent on their hire date determines the retirement formula, which therefore determines how much they will be paying. I should also note, which is noted on my slide, that unrepresented confidentials and executive team follow the mid-managers agreement to cost share, and it also are included in this contract amendment. Like I mentioned in the last slide, tonight is the first step in this process. It's a multi-step process, so I just wanted to go over some of the requirements in the timelines. These timelines and requirements are set by CalPERS. I mentioned already, tonight we're amending the CalPERS contract for the cost-sharing provision. Tonight we're doing the resolution of intent and the first reading of the ordinance. Afterwards, tomorrow, we're going to have start the process of an employee election with the affected members. After the election, the adoption of the final ordinance will occur on February 17th. And on March 21st, these employees will begin paying towards the retirement benefits in the amounts that I described in the previous slide. There is a fiscal impact for this. There is $384,000 in cost savings to the city budget. However, this is offset by $723,000 in additional costs due to the furlough elimination. At this time, I ask the council to adopt a resolution of intention to approve an amendment with CalPERS for Classic members cost sharing towards their employer rate per the applicable negotiated contracts for the bid managers, police officers associations, police sergeants, first level manager bargaining units, and also include unrepresented confidentials and executive team. In addition, I ask that you introduce an ordinance amending the city's contract with CalPERS that will implement the cost sharing arrangements with the above listed bargaining units and unrepresented units and waive the first reading. So at this time, I will take direction from the mayor and city council.
Thank you, Natalie. Do I have any questions of staff at this time? All right, I would entertain a motion.
I'll move the item.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further comments? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Next item is consent calendar. All matters listed under the consent calendar are considered to be routine and can be enacted in one motion. There will be no separate discussion on these items prior to the time the council votes on the motions, unless members of the city council, staff, or public request specific items to be discussed or removed from the consent calendar for individual action. Is there anyone from staff or council wishing to have an item removed? Anyone from the public? All right. I would entertain a motion on the consent calendar.
So moved.
All right. A motion and a second. Any further comments? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Item number 17 under general items. Feather River Air Quality Management District Agreement number VF14-03. Acceptance of the Blue Sky Grant for $48,785 for the Yuba City Class 2 Bike Lanes Project 2015 and Agreement Number VF1404. Acceptance of Blue Sky Grant for $4,512 for the May is Bike Month 2015 project.
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. To give a little bit of background on the city's Bicycle Master Plan, it was adopted by the City Council on January 18, 2011. It was prepared by city staff with input from a Bicycle Master Plan Committee, and then upon adoption, we formed the Bicycle Advisory Committee to assist us with implementation of the plan. So in the Bicycle Master Plan, they identified some priority long-term projects. On the screen is a list of the projects, and so as we go through each year looking at potential grant project applications, we go to this priority list to determine which projects we're going to submit applications for. So as you can see, the top five projects are partially completed. The sixth project, we just received a grant at the end of last year for installation of bike lanes on Franklin Road between Harding and Walton. And so the next project on the list was Tea Garden Avenue. And so when Frackman put out their call for projects last year, we submitted two applications, one for Tea Garden Avenue between Pluma Street and basically the Levy Bike Path. And we also submitted an application for May's Bike Month 2015. The city has acknowledged May's Bike Month for the last 4 years through the assistance of Frackman, and this year we'll be targeting schools similar to what we did last year. And so the item before you tonight is to authorize the Public Works Director to execute the two FRACMA agreements. The total grant amount is $53,297. In addition, we're requesting a supplemental appropriation of $51,203 from unallocated road funds to the project account for a total project estimate of $104,500. The time frame for the Tea Garden project is it has to be completed prior to the end of this calendar year. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Diana. Any questions of staff?
And this is not necessarily directly for this grant itself, but I'd like to ask a question on the striping that is being done for the bike lanes. What other fund resources have been utilized to stripe some of the lanes that are already current out there besides the Blue Sky?
We have multiple funding sources. We've used bicycle transportation account. We did some projects on Butte House Road. That was bicycle transportation account. We've got the FRACMID. We just received the, it's called the ATP through SACOG, that we were the active transportation projects. We just received that grant for Franklin. And so throughout the years, the city has been very active in pursuing grant projects for bike lanes and implementation of the bicycle master plan.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Do we have any plans for Peace Road now that the college is out there? Because I've been getting several calls on improvements made for bike lanes out in that Peace Road area because of the traffic that's coming through there.
So we just finished Class 2 bike lanes on Pease Road from Stabler up to the overpass. At the overpass, it changes to a Class 3 bike route. And then once you get over the overpass from basically East Onstott all the way to Live Oak Boulevard, there's bike lanes.
They're going to be further work down Pease Road, farther down by the residential areas, out by the Stabler and past that area.
You know, for further west on Pease Road, eventually there could be. We haven't done a lot of counts in that area to see how many bicyclists are actually riding on that portion of Pease Road once you get past the residential subdivisions.
A lot of cyclists out there.
Okay.
So we might want to look at that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Any other questions or comments? All right. I'd entertain a motion.
I'll go ahead and move staff's recommendation.
I'll second that.
All right, I have a motion and a second. Any further comments? All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? None. Motion moves unanimously. All right. And item number 18, Homeland Security Grant, presented by Chief Daly.
Good evening, Mayor Dukes, members of the City Council. Sorry, I can put my glasses on. First year with them. I'm before you tonight to talk about 2014 Homeland Security Grant. I'm before you tonight to talk about that specific grant and ask to accept funding for the 2014 Homeland Security Grant and authorize appropriate modifications to the Fire Department budget in the form of $45,638. In an effort for local agencies to better be prepared to deal with weapons of mass destruction, the Federal Department of Homeland Security, in conjunction with the state of California, has allocated funding to be distributed to all counties and local agencies within the state under the 2014 Homeland Security Grant. This grant is 100% funded by the federal government. For the 2014 Homeland Security Grant, the Yuba City Fire Department has been allocated $45,638 for the purchase of 5 thermal imaging cameras. The department's existing thermal imaging cameras were purchased over 10 years ago using grant funding as well. Our existing units are beginning to encounter maintenance and operational issues. In fact, just recently, we just repaired one of our units. It was almost $3,800 just to repair the one unit. These new thermal imaging cameras will replace the units on our first out engines, with the older units being placed on reserve engines as backup. So as I mentioned before, I'm here before you tonight to answer any questions and ask that you accept the funding for the 2014 Homeland Security Grant, which is 100% funded by the federal government, and authorize appropriate modifications to the Fire Department budget in the form of $45,638. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
All right. Thank you, Chief. Any questions of the Chief? All right. I'd entertain a motion.
I'll move the item. Second that motion.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes unanimously. Thank you
very much.
Moving on to item number 19, implementation of the last, best, and final offer of the Yuba City Firefighters contract. Natalie.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council members again. Tonight I'm here before you to implement the last and best final offer for Local 3793, the Fire Union. The city's employment agreement with Local 3793 expired on June 30th, 2014. City staff and Local 3793 are unable to agree on terms of a successor agreement after 16 meetings. The meetings began in January 2014. The city declared impasse on November 13th and there was no resolution at the required impasse meeting. The last and best and final offer terms are as follows. Employees pay the entire employee contribution towards CalPERS. This amount is 9%, which is the member contribution. Elimination of furloughs. Cap healthcare at the 2014 dollar contribution. Vacation and sick leave not counted as time worked for overtime calculations. Fire department staffing, according to ICMA recommendations, is two-person response companies, and this is in addition to three-person response companies. Acting pay or temps for vacancies and a first employee on overtime goes home from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. The recommendation is to adopt a resolution implementing the city's last best and offer final, last best and final offer that I just went over to the fire union that would be effective January 24th, 2015. I also adopt a resolution for CalPERS stating that the city is no longer paying the fire union's member contribution effective on the same day. At this time, I move it to the city council for action.
All right. Any questions of staff at this time? I'd like to open the public hearing. We have a number of people who have given written requests, and I have three speaker cards. I'm going to start with the three speaker cards, which you will be allowed 3 minutes to speak. The written requests will be allowed up to 5 minutes. So we will start with Arlene Motna. If you could go to the podium, state your name and address for the record, please. Next up is going to be Karen Cardicelli, just if you want to get in line behind her. Okay.
My name is Arlene Motna, 1409 Stafford Way, Yuba City, 95991. Okay, this is not a win-win situation for anyone. I do understand that. But having used the fire department before, I hate to see it leaned down any more than what it is because they go out for everything. Thanks to them, they saved my son when he had a heart attack. They were there before the ambulance and they helped him. Without it, he was extremely critical and would not have made it. I think that to take away from them at this time and lean them down even more is something that we don't want. Thank you.
Thank you, Arlene. Karen, you're up, and then after Karen is Rick Jimerson.
Good evening, Council. It's nice to see you. I kind of wish that you had called me after I got to hear what the official firefighter folks have to say, because my issue really is with regards to the fact that when I was on the council, we fought very, very diligently to go to a three-man engine for many, many reasons, including firefighter safety, response time, public safety, and issues with regards to the ISO rating impacts on fire insurance for small business, et cetera, which could occur if the rating is dropped because of the decrease in staffing. So all I would ask is that I feel like after fighting so hard for the three-man engines for the stations when I was on the council, it feels almost like a step backward considering the increase in the population since I was on the council and the increase in the area of responsibility that our fire departments have to cover. And with that, with all due respect, I'd like to submit that information. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.
Mr. Jimerson.
Rick Jimerson, 1020H Oswald Road and 95991. I'm a Sutter County resident, but I'm a Yuba City businessman as well as a property owner and business in Yuba City. And I want to make it clear at the very beginning that I'm not speaking on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce or any of the other boards that I'm affiliated with. I also, for fair disclosure, want to recognize the fact that, yes, in my family there is a firefighter. There's also a police officer local, and there's also a probation officer. So public safety is near and dear to my heart. Their safety as well, not just the public safety. And that brings up my concern, and I apologize with the me being out of town and yesterday being a holiday, I wasn't able to have a prior discussion on a number of the items to see what your resolution was really regarding. But I liken this to running my business. My offices throughout the United States, if I were to have three people in them, and I was to lay off one of those people or move them out for convenience or me not having the fortitude or planning to have made sure that I had all that was needed, I wouldn't lessen my productivity by 33%. I would lessen it by probably 50% or more, because each one of those people have an assigned duty. My way, even though I do know a few people here, and I have never been a firefighter, and I've never been out on a fire call and such, but I do notice that when I'm going through the community and watch the activity take place, there's usually one person that's either directing traffic or monitoring the truck, and there are two people taking protective action or an immediate action. So again, if you were to take one person away from a three-man crew, he or she, you haven't reduced it by 33%, you've reduced it by over 50%. I believe that's an unacceptable process. I would really encourage you to rethink this. I've been up here so often to compliment the city on what they've done, how they've thought out things and what they're doing. So I'm not meaning to make any enemies at this time, but I'm going to tell you the way I see it every time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick. All right, now we have the list of the individuals who had written requests prior to the meeting. We're going to start with David Jans, and then following that is Ken Campbell.
Ladies and gentlemen of the council, Mr. Mayor, citizens of this community, my name is David Jans. I'm the president of the Yuba City Firefighters Association. I want to thank you for the opportunity to discuss this topic, the staff report that you received from city staff, as well as what a risk would be to reduce staffing in this community. I only have 5 minutes to discuss this topic, so I'll get right to it. First off, in paragraph 1 of your staff report, it states that the city laid out its objectives, but in actuality, they laid out these some objectives prior to receiving the ICMA report. It's contrary to what you received. The city did lay out objectives. That was for employees to pay their portion of their PERS costs, their retirement costs, furlough eliminations, and a balanced budget by 2017. Firefighters did make a proposal accomplishing those objectives in January. But no response was received from the city, and negotiations were delayed by city requests, meeting only once between January and May, awaiting the ICMA report to come out. At that time, once the ICMA report was received, the objectives changed to include staffing cuts. This left only a few weeks before the contract expired in June. Furthermore, in paragraph 5, it states that the city objective is to reach an $800,000 cut. Firefighters, what it doesn't state is that firefighters are also required to meet the original objectives set forth at the beginning of negotiations, which includes what was once believed to be a temporary cut of furloughs. That price tag is an additional $575,000. So this means that it's a total price tag of $1.385 million that is being well documented in correspondence with city consultants, and it requires a majority of that cost to be picked up in staffing cuts. This cost also exceeds the overall city deficit for 2014-15. 5 total proposals were presented to the city, with our last and final proposal meeting the $800,000 objective. We also additionally offered to pay our entire PERS cost willingly and immediately. But this, along with all other offers, were rejected by the city. But if the true number is $800,000, I believe we are very close. But the bottom line is this. The report you received does not accurately depict the group of firefighters in a way they deserve to be depicted. What was presented in this report to you was a group that's unwilling to negotiate. But history will show time and time again that we have risen to the budget deficit call and willingly gave up in order to maintain staffing. We are not asking you for money. We are asking for safety. But that brings me to the next point, the adverse effects of these cuts. We all know that with less firefighters at scene, this means there's more risk to both you and firefighters who have sworn to rescue you. This means a slower rescue. National Institute of Science and Technology has proven that two-person companies are up to 30% less efficient than a three-person company. And furthermore, the federal mandate of OSHA's two in, two out would mean slower fire attack initially. The NFPA released further statistics in 2013 showing that fire may double in size every 30 seconds and can spread an 1,100% in the first 4 minutes. This means ultimately a lot more property damage. Additionally, higher workers' compensation costs were cited as being a reason for a budget deficit in 2008 and 2009. This was in your staff report as well. But a study of major cities shown that 54% increase in firefighter injuries occurred when they reduced from 4 to 3. We can only imagine what those costs would be from 3 to 2. And finally, in 2002, the publication titled Managing Fire and Rescue Services found that 3-person crews were about half as effective as 4-person crews. And 2-person crews weren't even considered worth testing. The publishing agency of this document was the ICMA. And finally, in conclusion, I want to remind the citizens of this community that this council was elected on a platform of public safety being their top priority. Reducing staffing levels to what they were nearly a decade ago does not meet that priority. Yet the population of our coverage area has grown, resulting in an increased demand for services and call volume risen 40% since the last 2-person engine existed. Our city can no longer risk running 2-person engines. They should exist only in our city's history. And finally, this group of firefighters carries out the mission of the city, and they carry out the mission of this fire department. They carry it well. We are passionate about our services that we provide to you, but if you're willing to make cuts to the level of services that we provide to our citizens, then that will be at your direction. It will not be because we are unwilling to negotiate, as your report suggests, or provide solutions to you. We strongly encourage the City Council to vote no or to postpone this vote and return to productive discussions in the interest of public safety. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. All right, next is Ken Campbell. All right, we'll move to the next, Kenny Smith.
Good evening, my name is Ken Smith. I'm a property owner at 1155 Pease Road. Honorable Mayor, City Council members, my name again is Ken Smith. It's my pleasure to be here this evening to have the opportunity to express my concerns with this staffing proposal for your fire department. I stand before you this evening wearing multiple hats. I'm a fellow frontline firefighter for Chico Fire Department. I'm also an appointed delegate for the California Professional Firefighters. But I'm also a taxpaying citizen in your community. I'm struggling with the idea that my wife's aging parents, who reside in the humble home that we purchased for them to live out the so-called golden years, are possibly at risk of losing the emergency services that we signed up for. I certainly wouldn't expect to see a tax decrease to offset the reduction in services. And I apologize if I seem a little agitated. It's only because I am. I personally started my journey here in Yuba City under the wing of many of these amazing firemen. I was 19 years old, wet behind the ears, naive, young, looking to find my way. And I was instrumental in actually pushing an ROP intern program through Yuba City Fire Department, which put a volunteer EMT and a simple fire science student in the back seat of the fire engines, completely unaware of the constant battle for a third professional firefighter on the rigs, as you so eloquently spoke of. At a time when staffing priorities were obviously out of whack, I just wanted to get in the game. The experience for me was a priceless pillar in my foundation. But often I look back and I regret it. I look in the mirror and see myself as a roadblock for the fight that these men were in at that time to secure proper staffing on their engines. The unintended consequence of my personal pursuit made the battle that much harder. Made it difficult. And for that, I apologize. I've kept in close contact with the brothers and sisters here in Yuba, and even had the great opportunity to come down and proctor your last apparatus engineer's test. To watch the department grow to the current three-person staffing model that's here, I'm filled with pride. It's a fact that three-person engine companies are exponentially more efficient and effective than the unsafe, unjustifiable two-person engine company. I don't need to stand up here and throw statistics around from the Institute of Standards and Technology made up of fire service professionals and amazing propeller heads that qualify the science behind our dangerous work environment. It's common sense. It makes my stomach turn to try and grasp the notion that the proposed staffing pattern is possibly based on the self-proclaimed leaders at the core of Better Communities, the ICMA, a giant networking system for career paper-pushing policy by propaganda managers. That their greatest occupational hazard is a paper cut. Local government managers tend to lean on the idea that ICMA provides them a safety net for bad decision making. I'm not here to challenge you. I'm here to empower you. Empower you to embrace the authority that these citizens have given you to squash this, table this, slow this train down. Please, this is a draconian approach to the rebound of your city's economy. There are safer alternatives, and I'm not going to stand up here and tell you that I know the solution for your specific department, but I will tell you that this facade of full coverage with less bodies is a joke. It's boots on the ground, it's sharp minds, it's strong backs, and it's even stronger hearts that protect your sick and injured and put those fires out. Please explore a better solution.
Thank you. All right, next is Brian Werda. Following Brian will be Karen Zavala.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Again, my name is Brian Werda. I live at 3838 Lincoln Road. I'm a resident here and a captain with the fire department. I left a better paying fire job in Sacramento to come work for my city, Yuba City. I take this passionately and don't easily come to something like this. This is a little bit out of my comfort zone, but I'm going to do it anyways. Plain and simple, the cuts that the city is recommending will put the citizens of Yuba City at greater risk. It's undeniable that there's a potential for greater property and life loss. It could happen to you. Councilman Buckland, the fire station responding to your house is Lincoln Road. Your station will be staffed now with two under this proposal. Mayor Dukes and Councilman Gill, the fire station responding to your homes at Butte House Road station. Your station will be staffed with two. Councilman members Cleveland and Edball, you are the lucky ones. Your stations will likely retain its current staffing unless there is illness or vacation. For those of you whose stations are staffed at two, did you know how quickly a fire can double? Every 30 to 60 seconds. If a two-man engine company arrives at your home, we cannot make entry until the engine from another station arrives. By this time, your house will be likely gone. I hope no children or elderly people are inside. If a three-man engine company arrives, we can make entry almost immediately to save your home and your loved ones, but not with a two-man engine company. Let's talk about how this impacts the business community. Kingsbury Incorporated decided to expand in Yuba City, and city officials are elated for good reason. Now you're cutting the fire station that will respond to a fire or industrial accident at Kingsbury. You're cutting that down to two-person engine company. Our ability to save the building and the lives of the employees will be greatly hampered. These cuts aren't good for business. I realize that the city council wishes to find ways to reduce operating costs across the board, but that cannot happen until city leaders begin planning for the future. Even if these staffing cuts take place, you haven't dealt with the big issue, overtime. The city is not currently actively recruiting firefighters, yet today we have 8 vacancies that are forcing our firefighting professionals to work an obscene amount of overtime. For example, in 2014, one of our firefighters worked the equivalent of 14 hours a day, every day of the year. Not 5 days a week, 7 days a week. I'm certain this firefighter would like to spend time with his family and his aging parents, but instead he answered the call of duty. He made sacrifices. You will continue to have overtime issues until we backfill some of these vacant positions. And even after these cuts occur, you will have vacant positions that are backfilled with overtime. But it is you, the city leaders, who have created this situation, not the firefighters. There's a multitude of options that do not include cuts to staffing and putting the lives and properties of civilians at risk. I encourage you to reconsider. I, for one, believe that we can reach an agreement that works for us and for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Karen?
He's ill tonight.
He's ill, not here. All right. Paul DeMeritt?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and honorable council members, and ladies and gentlemen. I'm a latecomer to this issue, but I'm not a latecomer to our community. I arrived here almost 23 years ago I'm a husband, I'm a father, I'm a grandfather. My 10th grandchild is on the way, and I'm a teacher. In fact, when I arrived here 23 years ago, where'd he go? Brian Warda was a senior English student of mine. I'm a proud man tonight. The guy's a good public speaker, and I appreciate his passion. I appreciate the passion of the men and women that serve our community in every respect, and especially in public safety. In my 23 years, I thank God that I've never had to initiate a call to my home at 1215 El Margarita Road here in Yuba City. But in my 23 years, I have initiated, and we as a faculty at Faith Christian School have initiated calls many, many times. In every single one of those times, the first responders have been Yuba City Fire Department. Every single time. Sometimes it seemed like seconds between the time I hung up the phone and the time these folks arrived. I don't know what we'd do if they weren't there as quickly. I work now, in addition to my work with Faith Christian School, with Ride Out Health. Tomorrow I'll be at Covalaud School in the morning presenting a presentation on healthy living to 520 students and their teachers. So kids, safety, health, well-being is my passion. It's been my career my entire adult life. When I talked with Brian about this issue, I'm a cut-to-the-chase kind of guy, even though it may not seem like it. And I just said, Brian, you don't have to convince me. Just answer two questions for me. One, is this decision going to imperil any member of your team? And he said, absolutely. I said, okay. Is it going to imperil my safety, the safety of my children, my grandchildren, the safety of any member of our community? He said, absolutely. That's all I needed to hear. I think that's all you need to hear. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. All right. Did Ken Campbell make it or not? All right. Is there anyone else from the public that would like to speak on this issue? Please step to the podium.
Hi, I'm Steph Racina, and I live on Sharon Drive in Yuba City. I think every one of these guys has come to my place saving my son's life. He has seizures, he stops breathing, he gets ridiculous lows, goes unconscious all the time. Sometimes I just can't give him enough CPR. I don't have the physical strength to help him. I can't give him IVs to raise his blood sugar. I tell you what, I go 911. My biggest problem is the signals to get them there. But they're always there. They go out of their way. My son has wedged himself between the headboard and the bed he's been under. He's broken glass before, falling. And they don't care. They rescue him every time, 100% of the time. And all I can say is my son would be dead if it weren't for the staffing levels and for these men coming over here. I wouldn't even talk about fire. That terrifies me. One of the few things that does. My daughter was on Walton Fire Department, and I had been on rescue with both Loma Rica and Browns Valley Fire Department. So I know the bravery that is required and the teamwork, the professionalism. And to have less would impact me. It may cost my son his life. I've had 3 heart attacks. I don't know if I could survive another one, but I know if they were there, I would be cared for. I don't know how many car accidents that you have seen or you've helped with, but I tell you what, if it weren't for the firefighters, the death rate would go up a lot. And I also know that they're right, the insurance companies, they know how quickly fire spreads. And if you've got federal and state laws impacting their ability to do the rescues and to answer the calls, yes, insurance will go up. But mostly, please don't sentence my son to death and all the disabled veterans who can't get help in time because there's not enough firefighters. All the car accident victims, there was just one on 99 in Lincoln. While we were here, there was somebody there to rescue them. Please see that they're there. If you have to use students, reservists, whatever it takes, please have them at least 3 per fire unit. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Is there anyone else in the audience who would like to speak on this issue before we bring it back to the council? All right, seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Bring it back to the council for comments.
First, I appreciate all the speakers that have spoke tonight. Much of it with passion, some of it with the prior history. Much of that prior history, we know. We understand it. I understand it. The men and women of the fire department, of our public safety here in Yuba City, are second to none in California. This isn't about the individual. This is about operating a city. This is operating at a service level that we can go, if not just a temporary basis, that we can continue to move forward and build our public safety to a stronger component. When we talk about response times, currently, half the time, there's only 4 stations open. I think that's important to know. Response times are longer on those days. If we can staff 2 of the stations with 2 people, that's all the stations being covered. Our response time should go down. I understand the fire component to this. We have a structure fire. The public needs to understand this, and I think we need to understand this. When that alarm comes in, there's 3 engines rolling. If it's a structure fire. The staffing of that is for fire management to determine which stations have which people. Brian, thank you for telling me that there'll be two people in Station 3. I've lived in my home for 20 years. When I moved there, there were two people in that station. We went to 3 just not too many years ago. That staffing level is really the paramount number. We understand that, but we struggle to be able to bring public safety to a level in Yuba City that provides a level, not just at fire, but we also have to look at the police levels. I understand fire's down. Fire's down some folks. Marysville, they're paying a firefighter $45,000 a year. They took 350 applications. More than that. Police officer in Yuba City, we have an opening. We can get 6, 7 to apply. We had to make some adjustments. We went through negotiations. We don't negotiate at the dais. Negotiations were 16 sessions of negotiations. The traction didn't occur. Without traction, this council has to make a decision.
To the mayor.
I'll leave it to the rest.
All right. Before you make any comments, let me just say one thing. And Councilmember Buckland alluded to this, but I'd just like to say 3 things. Number one is we don't negotiate at the dais. That's what we hire a negotiator to negotiate for us. And we've had 16 meetings since January of last year with the fire union. Secondly, we had 3 goals for all of our negotiations with all of our labor groups. One was to end our furlough. 2 was that the employees would pay their share of PERS. And 3 was a balanced budget by 2017. And we have stuck with that throughout the whole process. And those were the goals that we laid out from the very beginning. And then we paid for an independent report so that we weren't making this decision just on arbitrary facts of our own. So I just want to lay that out to the public and let you know the process that we've been through. Councilmember Gill, if you'd like
to. Yeah, first of all, I want to thank each and every one of the firefighters. I mean, you guys do a dynamite job. I've seen it firsthand. You guys represent the community in a very professional level. You put your life on the line every single day, whether it's at a car accident or whether you're going in a burning house. So first of all, I want to say thank you to each and every one of you guys, because you guys are the greatest asset of this community. And having said that, you're absolutely correct. Somebody mentioned that public safety is something that's very, very important to us in this community. Public safety comes in, you know, fire, police, obviously flood protection. That's kind of what the peril of this entire community has been. I was there at that point in time when we voted for 3-man engine on that council at that point in time. Looking back now, as far as what we see, one of the things that we came across with all the bargaining units is that at this point in time when we started these negotiations, the city was at and still is at a very tough time. We needed to balance our budget. We could not continue to operate the city in a deficit year in and year out. And our proposal coming back to all the bargaining units was, look, this was a 2-year deal that we're looking at, and we'll come back and revisit this after a 2-year period. Starting these negotiations early on, knowing that the contract was coming up, you know, in June, we started these negotiations back in January. Now here we are within the month of January, following January, and you've only got 4 more months left, basically in year number 1, before the contract's already done. So in essence, you've already kind of gone away with a year without reaching any kind of a negotiation coming across. Our goal here is not to make public safety worse in the sense that you guys have mentioned it is. Our goal is to eliminate the furloughs and make sure that we no longer have brownouts. We make sure that every single fire station is open every single day. That's our number one goal coming across. And eliminating the furloughs, our goal is to balance the budget. I mean, when it comes down to it, I mean, I've lived in this community 49 years. I've seen where the mall was, where orchards were. I've seen Walton Fire Department operating independently. I've seen 2-man engines. I've seen 3-man engines. I get it. This is my community. This is my life. This is where my children grow. I've seen firsthand when you guys responded to the 911 calls. This is not a long-term thing that we're looking at. We're trying to get through this tough time at this point in time. By doing so, this also allows the discretion up to the chief to see what engine companies he wants to have two mans and three. There's nothing in concrete from our council. We're not giving him direction that it has to be Fire Station 2 or Fire Station 7. That's up to him to decide on what day or when he wants to have that particular engines rolling with two men. The other thing this allows all to also to do that the chief's done in the past is possibly apply for the SAFER grant, which in the past has been in a range of $800,000. So there's other avenues that can come into the mix at this point in time. But going back to what our mayor said, is these have been our goals from day number one. We've had other bargaining units that have come a lot closer, that have closed the deal. And we feel from all the negotiations that we've done, we're nowhere closer today than we were when we started these negotiations. And I was hoping that we would not get to this point in time. And I'd love to see all of you guys or your representative come back to the table, negotiate this deal out. But I haven't seen any of that. And that's where the mayor said negotiations don't happen on the dais. They happen with the negotiators. So that's all I've got. All
right, thank you. Mr. Cleveland, any comments?
Being a little bit newer to the council doesn't mean that I'm not well-versed in negotiations and issues with public employees. It's 8 years at the county with a staffing of double of what Yuba City is, plus I've been through this a few times already. While this council previously had set certain goals of moving toward a balanced budget by 2017, the furloughs and the PERS, those are similar to what the county did. But there's one here that I have a question as to maybe is driving the level of disagreement and perhaps moving towards being rigid on moving towards a balanced budget in 2017, maybe slipping it to 18 could have made it a possibility of an agreement being made. So I'm not sure on their goals because I was not here to help set those goals. I tried to understand them, and that's from the very beginning of the time when I heard them, the goals. I thought, wow, that's pretty tight given the financials that I was given during the campaign, that would be very tough to do. So I had a question on that one item. We were given tonight, what would reduced engine staffing mean to Yuba City, a little item that was given to us. And then on the back of it, it does a comparison. And it kind of surprised me that it was so high. I know many of the cities and visited and had family in actually some of these cities. Manteca, Watsonville, Gilroy, down in Tulare, friends and family over time that have been there, and seeing the annual calls per firefighter. And out of 18, we were number 16 as we exist now. And the proposed staffing were in place as of last year, we would have been number 18 with 201 calls per, and the closest to us would have been Turlock at 179, and that's with comparable community, agricultural community, and at 201, when the average I would say is probably 150. It's just too many calls per firefighter per year on there. We're very high. We are at 8,450 calls, which is extremely high. I am a very strong proponent of three-man staffing, period. That something needs to be done to make that happen in some manner, and it should not be reduced. I did dig into the history. I got it from both sides and the community on how it was arrived at the three-man the voting and when that occurred. I like to do research, and I don't like making decisions until I'm sure of what I believe and why. It is a tough time. The city is trying, and one reason I'm here is to try to help, hopefully, move into a balanced budget, but not just that, but into an economic boon in Yuba City so that we can even have a surplus and actually start doing things in a positive manner, saying, wow, we have money to add things. And that is actually my goal to do from other decisions that we are going to be making in the next few years. So for me, I just can't see going below 3-man service. It's unacceptable to me at this with all the information that I've heard so far. There are a couple of alternatives that specifically one that became aware of and actually had became aware of it because I was discussing it with somebody and they said, well, that one, something very similar to it was proposed. And I was just trying to find out why it didn't go anywhere and who and where, which one refused it and stuff. And I was unable to finalize that even today. So I think that there is something out there that can be done to achieve that and not jeopardize the application for the SAFER grant. That's my real concern, because once that SAFER grant is applied for and we do get it, this problem goes away for a couple of years and we can start looking for revenue sources that'll make it permanent. So I think the implementing this right now, for me, is a little premature. We have not been involved in it, a couple of us here, in the depth. And so it's a hard decision to make, you know, right now when we're not sure of whether all stones have been turned.
Thank you, Mr. Playman.
Mr. Mayor, if I may interrupt, just as a point of clarification, the 5-year model projects the deficit being eliminated in 2018. So I know I've heard 2017 tonight. I just want to provide that clarification.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Stable?
I have not been a part of the negotiation process as being a new council member, but I did do my research. I spoke with many people, along with attorneys, as well as the president, as well as the chief, and so forth. And you can see I use a lot of notes. I've done the research. My bottom line with this is that I cannot justify jeopardizing safety at this point from everything that I've looked at. The concern for me is the safety of the residents, our businesses, our kids, and the firefighters. You work extremely hard. Me personally have had you at my home, at my parents' home. And if it wasn't for those split seconds, I would have lost a family member. So aside from that, I know if we go down and decrease staffing levels, those response times will be affected whether we want to believe it or not. It's just, it's simple math. And I can't see jeopardizing that at this point and not being a part of the negotiation tables, not having the conversation firsthand, doing the research, talking to several folks. That's where I stand right now. With the increase of population, I was born and raised here, so I've seen the population grow. We will continue to grow. Our whole arena is that we bring in economic growth. That means we're going to have an increase of population. And I think we're going backwards. We've developed a great department, and I just would hate to go backwards and then try to move forward. So that's kind of where I stand right now.
All right. Thank you. Any further comments? I'd like to make a couple comments. First of all, I've heard from a couple of the council members that we're not privileged to be a part of the negotiations over the past year because of their position being new on the council. And this has been a long road. We started this process January of last year, and we have met with the fire union 16 times.
and laid out our goals and objectives from the very beginning and talked about what we needed to be able to accomplish that. In fact, we, the negotiators, gave a menu option of many different options to be able to accomplish what it was that we're trying to do. And as Mr. Buckman said, nothing made any traction. And we have tried, and we've said that these are the different options that are available that will achieve what we need to accomplish to meet these goals that we've talked about here. We can't afford to continue to spend out of our reserves and not be able to get any concessions to do this. We can't do this. We have tough decisions. We have one of the finest fire departments, in my opinion, in the state of California. We have one of the finest police departments in the state of California. And our employees of this city are second to none. You have to go a long ways to find the quality of people that have chosen to live and serve in this community. And we are proud of you, absolutely proud of you. But we have budget constraints that we have to work with. John talked about the fact that we have brownouts right now. Every other day, one station is closed in this city. What we want to see is eliminate the furlough so that we can have stations open 365 days a year and serve the public with more stations 365 days a year. Yes, it is a reduction in staffing at two stations. Well, I won't debate that at this point. I understand it was two stations, but no, we're not going to debate from the dais. The point is that we have given options to make this happen, and it hasn't had any traction in the negotiations. It's a tough decision to make, but we need to make the right decisions for the fiscal viability of this city. So with that, I will entertain a motion.
Mayor, I'll go ahead and make a motion to recommend staff's recommendation.
I'll second.
All right, any further comments? All right, I'd like to take a roll call vote on this item, please.
Councilmember Gill?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Buckland?
Aye.
Councilmember Cleveland?
No.
Councilmember Didball?
No.
Mayor Dukes?
Aye. All right, the motion carries 3-2. All right, thank you for coming tonight and sharing your comments and concerns with us. We'll wait a moment here. The house clears.
Yep.
It's two. All right, now we have the, let me get back here real quickly, the business of the City Council. Council Member Cleveland, do you have any reports?
The only thing I have really here is meetings are getting up started this year, and I did actually attend one Housing Authority meeting. Made some, the Housing Authority is not just for Yuba City, it's for Colusa, Nevada County, now it's going into Yuba County, it's Sutter, it's Live Oak, and it's expanded its influence and strength in providing affordable housing. And of course, it's been a partner with Yuba City on a lot of their
redevelopment type stuff and helping them get road along Bridge Street to where perhaps maybe we can widen that someday. It's a difficult task to do that, and it was a good way to move that forward. But tomorrow we do have a meeting regarding that at 12 o'clock. We're having a special meeting and regular meeting at 12:15 at the Housing Authority on Joanne Way here in Yuba City. But that's it, and now let's get down to the real work and meet with the community, and hopefully we'll be moving forward well.
All right, thank you. Council member Didwell, please.
The meetings are going to start up. We already had a few of them this month. I was unable to attend because I was at the new council member and new mayor conference last week. So Mayor Dukes actually attended for me. So thank you very much. So starting next month, I will be attending the Yuba Center Transit, the Waste Management, and Animal Shelter meetings that will be coming up, and I'll keep you posted.
All right. Thank you. Councilmember Gill.
Great. Had the opportunity to attend the Yuba Center Chamber of Commerce Annual Gala, so that was a very nice event. Our own former councilman Craig Starkey was the voice of the chamber, so I thought he did an awesome job. Congratulations to all the winners, the Athena Award winner Amanda Jones for receiving that award. One of the businesses, Kingsbury, did receive that award, as well as many other businesses. So great job to Mr. Jimerson and the group there with the Chamber of Commerce, Ricky Schaffer, doing a great job there. Attended the Sutter Buttes Flood Agency meeting, was elected as chairman for this coming year. So looking forward to that. The levee projects are moving. Getting some work going. We did receive some state funds that were supposed to be due to us at the end of last year, so it was kind of a good Christmas gift coming across. In addition to that, we've got a finance committee meeting coming up here within the week after, so it seems like there's something always going on with that organization. We'll be going back to Washington, D.C. Here within the month of end of February, the last 3 days of February. Myself and Mike Amini and Scott Shapiro on the Flood Agency to go back and visit with those people again. And those trips are no country club trips. They have you up from sunup to sundown. And the sad thing now is, for whatever reason, United has gotten away with that direct flight to Dulles. So you have to zigzag around, so add a few more hours on travel time, so which is kind of sad for those that want to get there quick and catch the 5 o'clock, be back here at 9 o'clock. So. Doing everything we can to move and get flood protection and get these levees. And if everything goes well, we should be pretty close to getting everything completed this year in 2015. So comparison to where we were as a community with flood protection way kind of in the rearview mirror on how we've come a long way. And if you really take a look at that at the end when it's all said and done, how are we going to save this community in flood protection, not have to worry about paying annual flood insurance premiums on an annual basis, and you talk about the economic boom and businesses wanting to grow here, not be worried about being in a flood zone area. So I think that's a great win for our entire community. So that's all I've got.
Thank you, Mr. Gill. Mr. Becklin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Attended the SACOG Board of Directors meeting back in December. Nothing really great to report out of that. Just wrapping up some of the year-end materials. Came back that afternoon, attended Yuba City Transit. That was kind of a quick drop. I know three of us showed up, and the alternate decided he had other things to go, like to Seattle or someplace. I don't know.
I just want to let you know that I flew in early because I was told to be at the meeting, and I was in Seattle because somebody couldn't make it.
I was at the conference.
And so by the time it came back, there was three of us at the meeting.
So anyway.
We got it covered, yeah.
We had it covered. We had it covered well. Also, met with Mr. Jemerson and some of the formation staff for the California Farm Fest. We are looking forward to that event. It has been moved to not have conflict with Farm to Fork down in Sacramento during the month of October. We're moving to October. What are the dates? Thank you very much, Rick.
He's a ventriloquist, too.
Nicely done. Yeah. So we look forward to that. And this whole, the Farm Fest is really in its infancy, and the planning is moving forward. The snowball will get bigger. It will be an amazing event to showcase the Yuba Sutter area. So we're looking forward to that. And then I did take a short vacation and tried to seek warmer weather. That didn't work out because Florida was colder than here. But while I was gone, I was notified by SACOG that I'll be chairing the Innovation Services Task Force for SACOG. So an opportunity to move up into a leadership role down at SACOG and represent our community to a greater degree. So I'm looking forward to that. That's all I have.
All right. Thank you. Well, I attended the Government Affairs Committee with the Chamber. And the topic was tourism, and Rick was there for that also. And looking at how the Chamber moves forward with tourism here in our community, and it was very enlightening to be there at that meeting and to discuss the different options that they're looking at. Swan Festival, the food or Farm Festival, and different things that they're looking at bringing to our community to help promote tourism here. Also attended the Mosquito Vector meeting on the 8th. And let's see what else. And the Sutter Buttes Flood Control meeting with Chairman Gill. And the Gilsizer Drainage District also that afternoon. And so I think that is all I have and nothing else to report. So with that, meeting is adjourned.